Well, the goal of this session is to really equip you with some tools and perhaps some implants on that can enhance your recovery and help you bring success to an outpatient total joint program. So for full disclosure, everybody up here is conflicted with being a consultant with DJO. Our first speaker is Dr. Michael Meneghini at the University of Indiana, who's done some cool work on some tools that can allow you to figure out who's a good candidate for outpatient joints. Feel free to interact throughout this session. We got microphones everywhere. If you have questions, even in the middle of the talk, don't hesitate to ask. So we'll also have a little session afterwards for question and answer at the end of the session. So without further ado, we'll have Michael come up and talk to us about outpatient total joints.
All right, thanks, Ray, and thanks for hanging out in the lunch session. So as Ray mentioned, full disclosure, I'm conflicted about this because I work with DJO, but I will say that without the industry support, these meetings couldn't go on like they are, so I think it's important to have our industry partners, but be transparent about our conflicts, which is what I hope we're doing. One of the things that I'm gonna talk about, a few things, is about our move to the outpatient space and how we do that in terms of patient selection, which we talked about a little bit earlier, and I'll elaborate on that in more detail. Talk about the elements that make sense of an outpatient program, and then I'm gonna talk a little bit about cementless fixation in total knees, even though I know we covered that also at this meeting, but talk to you a little bit about one of the designs that we're pleased with and an evolution of that design in my history related to that. So, and I agree with Ray, this is not a big enough, there hasn't been a ton of questions from the audience over the morning or this meeting, but feel free to make this more interactive. Like, we really like to, I'd rather talk about this stuff than sit up here and just lecture. So if anyone has any questions, I'll try and pay attention, Ray will too. Throw your hands up and we'll stop and just talk about it. So there's my conflicts related to outpatient, again with DJO and then my ownership shares. So I think we can all agree there's a number of factors fueling interest in outpatient joint replacement. You know, surgeon ownership in ASCs, we talked about that earlier today, surgeon control over your OR environment. And here's what I think is a big, what is a big push right now is the payers are pushing it by cutting the reimbursement for an outpatient episode or to the outpatient episode. So I think that's happening. And now I will say that about 2 or 3 years ago, we did a study looking at whether patients were actually seeking outpatient joint replacement. They really weren't. But what I've noticed over the last 2 or 3 years, it's not that they come in necessarily seeking it, but they are much more amenable to it than they used to be. So clearly the word starting to get out is, and Becker's just published some data. It's very regional dependent because of the CON states, but already in the state of Indiana where I am, 30% of all primary hip and knee replacements are done now as outpatients, which blew me away. And there's a number of states, now, not surprising, it's correlated with ASCs that do joint replacement, but a number of states in the U.S. already are at 30%. Surprising. So, you know, it's here to stay. We have to learn how to do it. And so I'll share with you some of the things we think is important. Look at the projections here. Over the next decade, they expect 77% total hip and knee replacement growth. Only 3 of that will be inpatient. The rest is outpatient. So these numbers are pretty staggering. Almost a 500% increase in knee outpatient, and a 600% increase in hip outpatient. Here's the, again, Becker's keeps really good track of this for the obvious reasons in their ASC publication. They expect that we'll cross the 50% mark in 2026. I would argue that we might even go before that depending because of the payers and the government. So stay tuned, maybe that'll be even sooner. Here's one of the main external forces, Medicare spend for total joints. And this is 2014 data, so you can imagine it's worse now. $50,000 per hospitalization in 14, that was a $7 billion annual spend. And they know, the government knows, the payers know that it's less in the outpatient space. So it's not surprising when the payers are starting to guide their patients towards it. The key is how we do it safely, right? And CMS already signaled that. When last year, the beginning of last year, they took total knee off the inpatient only list, and we think the hips are gonna come some point following it. So, you know, stay tuned, right? But the writing's already on the wall, so we have to learn how to do this. So here's what we see as the essential elements. I talked about this earlier today in the talk during the session. You got to have a perioperative staff. You have a, I really think this is probably the most important one, is a partnership and coordination with anesthesia. It's critical to getting these patients able to go home the same day. Multimodal pain control, perioperative medical program specialist. The education piece is huge. I think you heard that this morning over and over again. The first thing you need to do is tell the patients that they're going to go home the same day. If you have someone tell them that that's unreasonable, that'll sabotage your program. Got to have good staff nursing support, and then we'll talk about the patient selection. So some of these slides you're going to see before, if you were here in the morning session. Patient selection is multifactorial. Motivated patient is a clear predictor that they'll go home. Family home support, their preoperative physical mental condition, and then minimal preoperative narcotics. So finally, let's talk about the medical risk. This is the key. As I mentioned this morning, selecting a young, healthy patient is relatively straightforward, but that's probably a small percentage. Right now, I think in the United States, the data is around, even though there's certain states are at 30%, I think in the country it's still, 15 to 20%. And I don't know how we're gonna cross into the 50% and get into the Medicare patients without getting a little bit better at what we do. So that true transformation will be when we enter the older patient population with more medical comorbidities. So I showed you this morning about the difference between ASA and the Aura score that we developed. ASA is pretty crude. It's 40 years old, so a lot has changed. It was never, ever designed to predict. I don't even know if ASCs existed in 1978, to be honest with you. Ambulatory surgeries were not common in 1978. So to use a score that was not even remotely designed for this seems a little bit archaic in our mind, which is why we embarked on this. And again, 304 anesthesiologists, only 3/4 of them responded, and here was a take-home message. All they did were, if you look at this study, they just were rating 10 hypothetical patients, and they only agreed on about 6 of those consistently. So even the authors of that study 40 years ago said it's useful, but suffers from a lack of scientific precision. Now, as you know, it's a whole number system, so ASA 2, 3. So right now, if you listen to most outpatient recommendations, they say, if you have ASA 1 and 2, you're fine to be done in an ambulatory surgery center. And if you have ASA 3, you shouldn't be done in an ASC. That should be an inpatient. That's the way almost all criteria here are currently talked about. But I will tell you that, look, a BMI over 40 puts you at ASA 3. We have plenty of patients we do in our ASC that are BMI over 40. 41, 42, 43 with no diabetes, otherwise healthy. Men in particular, they have no problem being done as outpatients. So here's a classic example, and I give my perioperative medical specialist who developed this the credit. This was he wanted to compare and contrast the difference between patients who can be done as outpatients and what ASA is. So here's a patient number one, poor pain tolerance, history of postoperative ileus. They'd be graded as an ASA 1, and someone with stable coronary artery disease, which we encounter frequently, that's an ASA 3. That first patient, we would do in the hospital every single time because that ileus worries us. That's something we have to watch very closely. And so we would not do them in the ASC. But that stable coronary artery disease patient, we would do in the surgery center no problem as long as they meet the criteria, as long as their coronary artery disease is controlled. Most of these people have either had a stent or whatnot and are doing just fine, have good exercise tolerance. They can be done in an ambulatory surgery center quite safely. So here's one of the things that, one of the reasons we embarked on this years ago, and it's turned out to come true, is we were concerned that as we did more and more patients in surgeon-owned ambulatory surgery centers, and that the forces pushing this, like the payers and the government, we wouldn't be ready to predict who could be done in these places safely and that it would harm patients. Well, last year, this was a Kaiser USA Today report, investigative report, and I'm sure this is the beginning of these to happen every so often. And it was picked up by all the news outlets, and it talked about tragic deaths at surgery centers. So the issue, obviously, is they expect us to have some reasonable way of selecting which patients are to be safely done in these surgery centers. And even the reporters that wrote this article, you can see doctors can use an anesthesia risk assessment to screen out fragile patients. Healthy score gets a score of 1, and a score of 5 means the person is nearly dead. That's what was in the article. So, they look to us to sort of lead the charge on this. They expect us to find safe ways to bring our patients to these environments, and so we've tried to do that over the years. And we first started on this. It's been a long labor of love, I guess. It's been about 5 years since we started this, and I'll share you some of the data. Pete Cacovello, my internal medicine colleague, gets all the credit for the score itself because he developed it. And 5 years ago, I just told him, Pete, when I ask you to do a patient who's early discharge, and then it was just going home the next morning, I said, what goes through your mind? Can you tell us, can you put down on paper in an algorithm form some sort of method to your medical criteria? And so this was his way of doing that. So we published the first data in 2017. Here's the components. So, and now that we're not under a 6-minute time crunch, I can go through a little bit more detail what the score is like. So you can see there's the 9 components: general health, hematologic, not surprising, number 3, cardiac, has a fair amount of work in it. And I'll show you how the software works as well. If your score, if your patient's total score is below 60, you're totally fine to do those patients in an ambulatory surgery center. And about once a quarter, I talk to a patient and I tell them, where would you rather go? And in our practice, the patients decide. They decide they want to go to the ASC, that's fine. And they run into my internist who puts the score on them, and I get a text from him that says, or a score over 60, we got to move them to the hospital. And that's fine. So we've agreed to let the data continue to guide us, and we've switched those patients to the hospital. So here is our initial data of over 1,000 patients. I'm going to go to the update because it really describes it even better. It's more robust data. NYU corroborated our data when they looked at it independently. So obviously we have conflicts. We developed the score. It's great to have others, and we encourage others who are willing and interested to do it. In fact, if anyone in the room wants to do it, we'll sign an NDA. You do it. We'd love to have other people validate it, because we want to, you know, no good technology that is worth it, you know, if it's good, it'll stand up to the test of external review. So we're glad to have NYU do it. We're looking for more people to do it, and so far it confirmed what we thought. Here's the take-home sort of slide, if you will. The x-axis on that graph is length of stay, same-day discharge, and the y-axis is the score. So blue is ASA, and red is the OAR score. And what you want is a steep slope, right? You're trying to determine, you want something that says day one, or same day, and next day patients are markedly different. If it's flat, that's not a good score, and we'll show you some of the further data. So this has now been published. This is almost 2,000 patients now, so much more robust data. And if you look here, the red bars are if you expand the score to be less than 80. So the score is meant for 60, and we made that cutoff strict for a reason. We'd err on the side of safety, right? Keeping more patients out of the ASCs. I know that's not what the future wants, but that's what we were doing. If you expand it up to 80, you see that the positive predictive value goes even higher. And so this is an ideal confirmatory tool or test. And if you bump it up to 80, it nears the nearly ideal 100% positive predictive value and specificity. That's great for a confirmatory test. I said this morning, but I think it's really important to drive this home. If you go back to your statistics, this is if you have a patient and you say, this patient's good for the ASC, I think, this test will confirm it. It is not a screening tool. So if you look at the false negative rate, sensitivity, those are all indicative of a poor screening tool. So you can't line up 100 random people who you pick out of your patients with all kinds of comorbidities and say, or a score, tell me who to take to the surgery center. But that's okay. I would argue it's probably not what this tool is designed for. There's our readmission rates. Again, I showed those this morning. We're very happy so far with being, and good, we're not aggressive. I don't try and talk people into the ASC or same-day discharge. But if they're appropriate, we certainly do that. And right now it represents about 15 to 20% of our practice. And so there's our readmission rates. And I would argue that that's probably biased because they're healthier patients, but that's the way it should be. Here's what the score looks like. So this is the login screen. I'll just show you, it's taken us a couple years to get the software so that people can use it quickly. Most people who are using it now, it goes into their workflow and their advanced provider. Or so whoever's doing their medical screening, either the PAT or what have you, all you do is put in your patient data, right? So here's sort of here's the general screen. I'm going to draw your attention to two things. Number one, there's the 9 systems you work through. They all have one screen. There's an option. We wanted to make this efficient because there's been some criticism that it's 58 questions. Well, that is 58 questions. You can click no to all. So once you get used to doing this, RPA can do this in under 30 seconds for a healthy patient. But that's appropriate. They're healthy, right? Once you know the score, I would argue that if they're not healthy, you have to take a little more time answering questions, and I would argue that you should take a little more time investigating that patient if they're not healthy. If it was my family member, I'd want you to spend a little more time before you take them to an ASC. So the score is working, the software works as we intended. You then get a score printout, so 30 seconds, you get through it, it gives you an assessment score right there, that's the screen you see. It'll show up red if it's above, which is indicative of the red flag that you should pause a little bit. One of the things that we really wanted, I don't know if any of you are familiar with Napster back in the day, we're sort of like sharing technology. We were very adamant that, and this is, some people may think this is a burden, but you need to put in your readmissions for any patient. So once 90 days goes to the patient, it'll lock you out unless you put what happened to that patient. And there's a reason, there's a method to that madness. We're not trying to create stress in your life. The reason is because this data will only make this better, and we need to do this as a profession. So you'll get a dashboard. So if you do use the score, you get a dashboard as often as you want that shows your data compared to everybody else who's using it. Right now we've got about 4,000 patients in the database. And our goal is, as we get 20,000, 30,000 patients, we can then make the score, you know, whatever, version 2.0, make it even better. And that's when that large data set combined with the granular metrics that we have, that will be what we're really, really excited about. So, and you'll be able to follow your progress along the way, right, as you embark on outpatient joint replacement. So I think this is sort of the key, it's one of my favorite slides about doing outpatient joint replacement, especially in an ASC. We're big believers of standardization, and that's not uncommon in joint replacement. But it's even more important in ASC, because the people that are there, maybe they're used to eyes or hands or ankles. They're not used to hip and knee replacement patients who can have fluid shifts and fluid swings in the PACU. That's not going to allow a patient to leave in a number of hours. So these sort of components, you need to have a consistent product arrive in the PACU. Put the assembly line there. I know that seems a bit much with patients, but for joint replacement, I really believe this process improvement should be something you focus on. So operative time, blood loss, you should know those, and those should be very consistent. Those are the two metrics that we follow closely. Our operative time is plus or minus 5 minutes on all of our hips and knees, and our blood loss also very consistently very low in the ASC. So I'm a big believer of that. So what does my current total knee practice look like? Well, everybody screened with Aura. We use a pivacaine spinal currently, and we're studying that with an adductor canal block and a paraticular injection. I tend to use I'm conflicted because I work with the company, but I use Empower 3D bearing, which is a conforming bearing. I know we had a session on conforming bearings earlier. And then cemented versus cementless for me is an age and bone quality stratification. Okay, so most of them, because my patients are younger in the ASC, the majority of my total knees in the ASC are cementless. And that's just because there's a selection bias there. In the majority of our young patients, we do cementless knees. And as I mentioned earlier in the session, we are trending towards not resurfacing the patella in those patients now. So there's some techniques I think you can use that help you minimize blood loss, because that's one of the things we talked about. The caveat with uncemented knees is that they bleed a little bit more into the joint, not a hemoglobin drop, and we just published on that. So we don't use a tourniquet. We navigate the distal femur to avoid a big hole in it. We use an additional dose of TXA, and then we don't resurface the patella, which minimizes some more bleeding. So we do all these things to minimize blood loss and utilize that cementless technology. We've been very happy with it. So why do we talk about cementless fixation? Well, there's some good data from Rich McCalden, over 6,000 joints, and also from the California database that show that there's earlier loosening in patients who are younger. Now, in old patients, if they're 65 or above, gold standard, cemented knee, no problem. Now we obviously discussed this morning that cemented fixation is not perfect, but in younger patients, this is the data that drove us to really consider it and employ it. Now, I know the registry data hasn't shown it yet, but I think the thing about the registry data is there's some older designs sitting in the registry data that I would argue are not optimal. So here's some basic science data. Cement is not a durable interface. We know that. We looked at a number. This is a study out of CORE in 2014, looked at retrieved tibias, and what happens is you see the bone trabeculi pull slowly away from the interlock. Now, I know there's some small case series out there of young patients under 50 or under 60 who've done well with cemented knees. And so certainly it's not wrong if you do cemented. It's just our preference that we believe cementless knees now have the technology has caught up, and we're able to do it very safely in young patients. So here's some original studies. This is one of the things early, very early in my practice that turned my attention to it. Merrill Ritter and I looked up his series, which was pretty revealing because he was an adamant cemented fixation user. I mean, adamant. Used to argue, and if anyone saw Merrill, he would argue vehemently for cement. So we looked up this series. He had already stopped operating. He was done at that time. We looked up his series of, he did a small subset of cementless knees back in the 80s. And interestingly, we followed them out to 20 years, and same equal survivorship of his cemented versus press-fit AGCs. The difference was he had selected those patients out, and they were younger by a decade. And these were the x-rays. We sat and looked at them together. It was great. Here's those interfaces that you see right there. That's what we would see routinely in those cementless knees. And it got me thinking that, boy, if you can get a mechanical osseointegrated interlock, just like we do on hips, that hopefully is a fixation interface that's going to last a long time and potentially more durable than cement. So I think right now we know there is sufficient evidence to support it. You know, stay tuned. The registry data needs to catch up. And I think a lot of us feel confident in the improved biomaterials. It does not mean that you can ignore patient selection or that you can ignore implant design factors and surgical technique. Those are paramount, and I'll explain a little bit more. Think about that. I want to thank Leo Whiteside. Whenever I talk about press-fit knees, I went to visit him, and he was really helpful in teaching me a fair amount on press-fit knees, as well as the surgeons. So I did no press-fit knees in my residency, but my fellowship at Mayo, there was a couple surgeons there, Dave Llewellyn and Arnold Hansen, who were doing cementless knees. I learned a ton from them as well. So, you know, kudos to the people who started me on that path. Patient selection is important. Since we have a minute, I went to Leo Whiteside to visit him early on, and I asked him about doing a randomized controlled trial. And if any of you have seen Leo speak, he's pretty dogmatic in his thinking. So I was young and naive, and I said, would you like to do a randomized controlled trial with me, cemented versus cementless? And he didn't even flinch, didn't even smile. He said, absolutely not. I thought, God, did I piss him off, or what did I do? And he said, because I don't believe that it's ethical to cement total knee patients. So that's pretty much where Leo stood on press-fit fixation. He wouldn't even do a randomized controlled trial because he thought it was unethical to use cement in his fixation. So I don't feel like Leo does. I think that it's totally fine to cement patients who are older. That will work very well. And so I believe in bone quality as the biggest predictor. We've seen some failures. When people get too aggressive and they try and do it in bone quality, it's not great. So just be aware of that. And I think we now know, after almost 40 years of design mistakes, successes, that there are some implant design essentials. I do think highly porous metals are important. You need a robust central keel or post. It doesn't matter. And again, this is one design. There are other designs out there very comparable that work very well. You need to have, I'm a big believer in peripheral fixation to anchor the tibial base plate down. Femur has a three-dimensional lock. That's why the femurs typically do very well. The tibia is where we've seen the failures, so you need to have pegs or screws. I don't like screws, so I believe in pegs. And I think surgical technique is critical. So here's just a brief, one of the tips that I learned from Leo Whiteside is making sure that that tibial cut is perfectly flat. You don't want ridges. So this is not as forgiving as cement, obviously. Understand that. You got to take a little more time. This is called a four-corner test. You press on all four corners, and if that tibia tray books open, then your blade has skived or it's, skived on the sclerotic bone. So the fellows usually get one or two passes at that, and if they don't pass the four-corner test, then I get to cut the tibia. But nonetheless, here's one going in. So now, once you see this, and you can see this is good bone quality. The tibia has to go down. You want to make sure when you impact this, because your press fit's predicated on those pegs and the keel, that the tibia is parallel and coplanar to your tibial cut surface. Does that make sense? The base plate has to be coplanar. I have my PA or my fellow or whoever is doing it watch from the side. If my fellow's doing it, I watch from the side to make sure it's in that plane parallel. And then whoever is impacting the tibia should be looking at it from the front. The modern design has been pretty successful. This was the predecessor to that. I was fortunate, full disclosure, to work on the Stryker design, which sort of the predicate. That's why you'll see similarities. It's a design that works. And so we did 189 consecutive four-peg press-fit tibias. That we've looked at, no revisions, reoperations, or implants radiographically loose, And the majority of what we just looked at this a few weeks ago, just got the data, the radiolucent lines actually that you see early, the majority of them resorb. So the highly porous metal combined with good stability will do what you should hope that it will do, and it will really form a good osseointegrated surface. So I think one of the features about this design that DJO has is I think it's best in class features. It's got all the central, it's got the central keel, the peripheral pegs. I like one of the added features that it's an asymmetric tibial base plate, so that it has even more surface area on the tibia for bone ingrowth and bone contact. And then in addition, it's obviously got a conforming poly option, which I think is an added advantage. And Scott Banks is gonna talk to you about the design behind all that and the premise behind it. So in summary, I think patient selection is critical to the outpatient process. I believe we hope that the OR score is going to continue to get better. We do believe it provides value. We use cementless fixation for our younger patients, and then always just keep patient safety first in your mind as you consider doing these younger active patients in ambulatory surgery centers. So thank you.
Open that picture with you and Leo and Leo's OR. As Scott's coming up to the podium, any initial questions here from the audience? How many folks here? Yes, Henry.
Mike, you talked about the limitations of your score as a screening tool. That's really important for the orthopedic community in general. When are you going to develop something that's better suited as a screening tool?
Yeah, so I think it's going to be really challenging to do that. This was focused on the medical aspects, and I think screening tools are hard in something that's so multifaceted as predicting a location or an early discharge, because there's the social issues, there's the patient motivation issues, how you can, and quite frankly, assessing a patient motivation, you know, a lot of patients are like, oh, I'm really motivated, or I have a really high pain tolerance. Usually when they lead with that, it's the opposite, right? So I don't know how we can do a great screening tool where you could line up 100 people and just have a score tell you who should go there. I'd rather have that the surgeon and the patients identify themselves as a candidate to go and someone confirm that. But I understand what you're saying. I just don't know that we'll get to that point quickly.
I mean, the issue is that you've got a lot of experience and you have insight, okay? And so maybe if you choose somebody who you think, based on all this experience, is a good outpatient candidate, somebody who doesn't have that experience or insight
sure, might make a
need some guidance about which patients to start with. So, you know, I think we still need to work on, for the community at large, here is a tool that tells us, as a screening tool, which patients are medically reasonable to think about.
Yeah, so medically, I think that as we get larger data, we'll be able to refine the questions, the statistics. So there's two things that when we get to, I don't know what the number will be, 10,000 patients that we're excited about. Is number one, diving into the 58 questions and finding out should some be weighted a little bit more or some less. The great thing is, as we've got this data coming in, it's from institutions outside of us. Because we have experience, one of the things that I think Aura needs to take a next step in is being broadly accepted into programs that maybe don't have the same partnership with anesthesia or, you know, all those things that go into it. But as we get large data, hopefully then we can weight it better. And then maybe to your point, maybe we can look at the data and see if there's ways we can make it a better screening tool. But I think the statistics will have to drive that. But your points well taken.
It's hugely helpful, but we need to be able to take it further. And as long as you
agreed.
Continue to look at it and move the bar forward, that potential for ongoing contributions.
Yeah, and we just needed more data, more patients, bigger numbers. And the first step for us, this has been 5 years worth of work. I mean, this is the issue. I know everyone wants this thing that's like, tell me who to take to my ASC. The reality of this is we've been embarking on this is it takes a lot of work and a lot of data, and it's going to take more work and more data. But the good thing is we at least have the method and the ability from a data entry point to get the data. And then now we'll be able to, I think, become more powerful over time. So, but great point. Thank you.
Thanks, Michael. Thanks, Henry. You probably know Dr. Banks from a lot of his work in vivo fluorokinematics. Scott's going to come here and talk to us about dual pivot kinematics and the 3D knee. Scott?
Thanks, Ray. So I know when you looked at the plan for this course, you saw engineer talk and you put like double stars on it, right? I'm not expecting that. But we'll get through this, and hopefully there's some useful information. Like Michael, I am a consultant for DJO Surgical. I get royalties on the sales of the device that I'm going to be speaking about, so obviously there's a conflict. What I'm going to do is talk about, you know, what we know about knee mechanics and knee kinematics and how that affects the patient experience and their function, what we designed, what we were aspiring to do, and then confirming that, in fact, it works the way that we designed it to. So what do we know? Since about 1836 and the Weber brothers, subsequently Brandigan and Vachel in 1941, and many others since, we've looked at passive knee kinematics during squatting, kneeling, lunging sorts of activities, and there's a stereotypic pattern of when the femur is flexing with respect to the tibia, there's less tibiofemoral motion medially than laterally, and so we've got this sort of rubric of calling that a medial pivot pattern of motion, and I think that's what most people have been sort of inculcated in what knee mechanics are. Since about 2008, as the technology for quantifying in vivo tibiofemoral motions has advanced, we've been able to look at people walking, running, doing ambulatory sorts of activities, and we've seen something very, very different. That is, in the stance phase of ambulatory activities, we actually see less lateral tibiofemoral translation, a little bit more medial tibiofemoral translation. And so if you're going to use that rubric of where's the pivot, you would say it's actually lateral in the healthy cruciate intact knee during ambulation. So the knee does different things depending on the arc of motion it's in, the activities being performed, and that makes sense as different soft tissues are recruited and de-recruited over the range of motion. Other things that we know about how knees work. Knees with intrinsic stability show greater functional strength. So let me elaborate on that. We know in the sports medicine context that folks who have ACL deficient knees, for example, if they're non-copers, it means they need bracing or surgery to recover normal functional activity. But those that are characterized as copers are able to beneficially co-contract their hamstrings to provide that dynamic stability to the joint, and those folks can do reasonably well without bracing or surgery. The price they pay is that by co-contracting the hamstrings, it requires a lot more quads activity to counteract that flexion moment that the hamstrings provide. So it requires more energy to perform activities, and it puts a much higher compressive load on the joint. So it's not necessarily a compensation strategy that we want our TKA patients to adopt. So really, the ideal total knee arthroplasty is going to be one that the patients perceive as stable, that they don't need to recruit the hamstrings as a dynamic agonist to stability, and that will allow them to use their extensor mechanism as efficiently as possible while keeping the compressive loads on the joint as low as possible. Other factors that we've documented in a variety of studies, for example, there's very clear trends in what geometric factors affect weight-bearing knee flexion. For example, if you can keep the femur more posterior with respect to the tibia, you gain a degree and a half of weight-bearing flexion for each millimeter of additional posterior translation. More posterior slope up to some reasonable limit corresponds to the maximum range of flexion where you get impingement occurring. And then restoring the posterior condylar offset. This probably is not very important in PS knees, but in CR knees, it's one of the ingredients that can be used to get good weight-bearing flexion. And the statistics showed, at least for passive weight-bearing flexion, you lose 6 degrees of flexion for each 1 millimeter diminishment of the posterior condylar offset. Other things, we've always been concerned about wear. We know that cyclic sliding is that predominant mechanism of wear that's not fatigue-related, and that if we do something to augment the polyethylene wear properties, we can mitigate that to some extent. So what did we design? We designed an asymmetric, ultra-congruent design. This is the so-called 3D bearing or the data-driven design. And the idea is that, like the healthy, intact, normal knee, it's going to provide intrinsic stability in that lateral compartment in the range of ambulatory activities. And so if you look at the femur, it has that single sagittal radius from hyperextension out to about 70 degrees of flexion that gives you a spherical lateral articulation over that range of walking and at least initial stair climbing. And then the medial tibial plateau is also curved, but kind of titrated so that it provides reasonably good anterior-posterior stability and flexion as that lateral compartment becomes progressively more lax in deep flexion. If you look at the coronal profiles, we widened the medial femoral condyle so that we got lower contact stresses, and that also had a secondary benefit of lateralizing the trochlea for the patella by a couple of millimeters, and we believe that also is a beneficial change. So it's a stable joint that is intended to allow you to have more natural muscle activation and patellar tracking. To address easy range of motion, we put that tibial sulcus, the dwell point or the deepest point, about 5 millimeters posterior to the AP center. We put that thickest part of the posterior condyles later in the flexion arc, so that essentially you elevate the posterior femoral cortex away from the tibia so that you don't get impingement until later in the flexion arc. And then the tibial base plate can be placed with posterior slope, whether you're retaining or sacrificing the posterior cruciate ligament, and there is going to be no impingement between the femur and the tibial insert in any of those cases. So it's a stable joint, and it really, we intended it to be optimized for good range of motion without a post and cam. We're on the second evolution of this design. The articular surfaces are the same as the implant that we brought out in 2003, but about 5 years ago brought it out, leveraging the anthropometric databases to give it more anatomic shapes, better locking mechanisms, more keel sizes, that sort of thing, and that's what you see is the Empower 3D knee. So does it work as designed? We've done a number of fluoroscopic studies to assess this. I'll briefly review a couple of them. This was a study of weight-bearing squatting done by some Japanese colleagues comparing a traditional symmetric CR with 10 of these so-called 3D or data-driven design knees. And with this asymmetric ultra-congruent bearing, those patients had statistically greater weight-bearing flexion, statistically greater tibial rotation, and statistically greater posterior femoral translation than did a traditional symmetric CR knee. It seems kind of contradictory that a more conforming design would actually have more flexion, more rotation, and more posterior translation, but we believe that's the case because we are better controlling the tibiofemoral articulation so that the soft tissues basically remain in a more supple range of motion, and so you get that rotation and posterior translation on the lateral side. In kneeling, very similar results, a good range of motion, a reasonable rotation, and posterior translation, especially on the lateral side. We've looked at these folks walking on a treadmill, which we can do fluoroscopically, and what you see is a very consistent pattern of motion. It's a ball and socket, so there's not a whole lot of conversation there. If there's weight across the joint, there's going to be a center of rotation laterally. It's very consistent as designed. So really, in this knee, for deep flexion, squatting, kneeling, lunging, we do see a medial center of rotation sort of pattern. For ambulatory activities, we see a lateral center of rotation, and that's where this dual pivot moniker comes about, is that it's reproducing to an extent what's observed in the healthy, cruciate intact, normal knee. Now, kinematics are awesome and exciting to look at, maybe, but what really matters is how these patients perform. And that is when you take them into the gait lab and have them do things like these stair step up over activities, what you see is that their implanted knees are 85% as strong as their healthy contralateral knees. That's not statistically different, but what's important when we look at the EMG in these folks, they are not adopting a co-contracting strategy. The strength they've got from their extensor mechanism, they're able to use, they are not fighting some kind of compensatory hamstrings co-contraction. How does this design wear? It's been tested at Clemson using their typical well-published methods. And what you see is for both the DCM or direct compression molded poly, the white stuff has very good 4.6, 4.7 cubic millimeters per million cycles of wear. For the moderately cross-linked vitamin E blended or so-called E plus poly, it's down around 2.5 cubic millimeters per million cycles. So it stacks up very favorably with many other popular bearing material arthroplasty design pairs. Does the PCL matter? This was originally designed as a PCL retaining device, but it is an ultra-congruent design. And so several surgeons have done consecutive randomized trials. Here I quote one, 56 consecutive patients. They were studied at 18 months post-op with fluoroscopy and clinical follow-up, and what you saw is if the PCL was retained, there was in fact more posterior femoral translation and deeper flexion. The clinical scores and functional flexion during squatting and lunging were the same with or without the PCL, but the passive range of motion and the kneeling flexion were greater when the PCL was released. This surgeon said, prefers to do a PCL retaining and said, when you do that, just go ahead and balance it as you normally would. Do PS knees flex more than this non-post-in-cam design? Same surgeon, two different published studies, but using identical methods. What you see comparing this asymmetric ultra-congruent design on the right with a marketed as high-flexing PS design on the left is that in a similar patient cohort, their clinical flexion was exactly the same. There's a lot of interest now about so-called medial pivot sorts of articulations. And so the question is, do those provide better or more natural kinematics than does this asymmetric ultra-congruent design? And I've been involved, hired by various companies to help them with studies of these. And so with Finsbury, with Mad Ortho, and with Medacta, we've reported the results on three different flavors of medial pivots. And what I did is I took those data you see in the blue at the bottom of this table with the data from the studies that I previously mentioned on the 3D knee articulation and just put it up there. This is not scientific, it's not a rigorous meta-analysis, but if you look at the mean maximum flexion during kneeling and squatting, you'd probably say, well, that looks about the same. If you look at the amount of tibial internal rotation in these maximally flexing activities, you might say, well, in the dual pivot articulation, that, you know, maybe that might be a little bit more. And similarly, if you look at the amount of posterior lateral translation in the dual pivot compared to the medial pivot, you might go, that's probably at least the same, or it might be actually a little bit more posterior translation there. So it's not scientific, but I think, you know, you can make those interpretations as you want. So, in summary, healthy knees do different things depending on different activities. I think that comes as no surprise to us, but really differs from some of the typical teaching that many of us have had. We designed this knee to provide intrinsic stability, really trying to model it as an ACL substituting sort of articulation. And as of this date, now 16 years into using this articular design, the clinical results, the flexion, the kneeling, lunging sorts of results are comparable or superior to anything that we see in the literature. We see the same clinical performance with or without retention of the posterior cruciate ligament without using a post and cam. The in vitro and now the clinical wear performance is very good, and this newer evolution basically fits the bones better and has better instruments to accurately implant it. So that's all kind of the theory and the function stuff, and everybody's going, that's great, but does it actually make a difference in the patients? And so I'll quote one study and then throw it back to Michael. And this is Michael's study of 120 consecutive patients with knee kinematics quantified intraoperatively, 0 degrees, 45 degrees, 90 degrees, and at maximum flexion, using the OrthoSensor instrumented trial to look at how the femur was positioned with respect to the tibia. And following up those patients with the new Knee Society score reported at 1 year, this is using a traditional symmetric cruciate retaining knee arthroplasty, not the 3D knee design. When those patients were grouped by where was the center of rotation in 0 to 45, 45 to 90, and 90 to maximum flexion, they could have a lateral or medial center of rotation. So for example, a lateral, medial, medial would be somebody that's lateral in extension and medial from 45 beyond. When they stacked that up, what they saw is that patients who had that pattern, lateral, medial, medial, were very satisfied compared to those with other patterns, any other pattern of motion. That particular finding was not statistically significant. They had more patients whose pre-apnea was never normal who improved with the lateral, medial, medial pattern of motion. That was statistically significant. In 100% of the patients who had that lateral in extension and then medial pivot afterward pattern were very satisfied versus zero for the worst performing pattern, which was a medial followed by lateral center of rotation, and that was also a statistically different finding. So even in a non-designed for articulation, if the patients manifest this pattern of motion that we now see in healthy cruciate intact knees, their clinical results were better. And then another question is, well, do these knees with this dual pivot total knee arthroplasty design, do they do as well or better when stacked up against other contemporary, well-placed, high-performing total knee designs? And that's where I'm going to throw the mic back over to Michael for the results of his latest study. Thank you.
Yeah, I just give a few slides on the clinical outcomes.
Be quick so we can get on to the next session that is on infection. So this is just a quick note on our clinical study that we just finished up. We talked about the kinematics. We'll get right to the data. And I think Scott highlighted this well, that this lateral pivot with an ACL intact knee is something that I never learned in residency because the data wasn't out yet. But certainly thanks to all the people who've done the work to show us what the normal kinematics are. Here's the study, and this is the clinical data Scott alluded to. We had 176 consecutive dual pivot knees, single surgeon, and we matched them as close as we could to 176 non-conforming knees. So this is just to look at the conforming bearing and this whole concept of, you know, dual pivot motion and how does it work clinically, trying to put the whole piece together. So we matched them with age, sex, BMI, and their ASA scores to get as close as we possibly could to match sets. And then we looked at our minimum one-year follow-up, the modern knee study score, UCL activity score, and a patient satisfaction score. Here's the take-home data. Here's the demographics. The dual pivots there on the left, traditional on the right. You can see they're matched almost perfectly, so our matching worked. We had a lot to pull from, but we were able to get almost exactly matched sets. And then the other thing we wanted to make sure of, because this wasn't a randomized controlled trial. So if you don't have an RCT, the next best thing is a very tightly controlled retrospective cohort study that you account for the confounding variables. And the confounding variables are anything that would affect pain or function afterwards. So we looked at fibromyalgia, lumbar spine disease, depression, preoperative narcotic use to make sure that we weren't attributing either a high or a, you know, low score postoperatively to one of those things, right? So they were very well matched. And then finally, we want to make sure we didn't have more varus or valgus in one knee because those may behave differently and they were identical. So here's the take-home method, or the take-home message rather. If you look at it, all the PROMs were basically the same. So not any major difference, satisfaction, et cetera, very tightly controlled. But there was two statistically significant differences, which I think finally drives home all the work that Scott has been doing and all the authors who really, or all the researchers who look at this normal kinematic pattern. The things that were better were in early flexion activities. So pain with level walking, you'll notice both of those, both the mean outcome score for pain, as well as those who quantified it as none, were statistically better in the dual pivot bearing. So flexion activities, no difference, is probably what you would expect rather, you know, honestly. But in the walking metrics, those things that are between 0 and 45 degrees. Now, one of the things we haven't looked at, which we need to, and Scott's enlightened me, he's taught me more about kinematics in the last few years than I've ever knew, but we need to look at things like going down an incline. That's probably one of the more challenging things to do with knees. So we're trying to get our gait lab is more formalized now. We're just trying to get a downhill incline to look at some of these things to find out if the conforming bearings are better than traditional non-conforming bearings. So stay tuned, but our study methods were encouraging, and so I think we've been very happy with these results over the last 4 years using this device. So happy to entertain questions. I'm going to skip through the surgical technique and get right to the end because we are running up against the time. So thank you very much for your time and attention.